Hello, welcome to lesson 3 of the Practical OSPF series. Today's lesson is all about hello packets. I'm going to show you all the pieces of information inside a hello packet, and we'll talk through each of their purposes and how they are used. As we mentioned in a previous lesson, hello packets are sent by every OSPF router for the purpose of discovering other OSPF neighbors. These hello packets are sent periodically to the multicast address 224.0.0.5. This address will reach any OSPF router. By default, for the most common network types, these hello packets are sent out every 10 seconds. But there are other network types that we're going to talk about with different defaults. And you can, of course, configure any hello interval that you like. Now, some network types do not support multicast addresses, meaning you can't send something to a multicast address. These are known as non-broadcast networks, and we're going to talk about them in more detail later on in this series. But for those types of networks, since you can't send something to a multicast address to discover other neighbors, an administrator needs to manually configure the neighbor's IP address. In those cases, the hello packets are then sent unicast directly to the IP address that was configured manually. This is how hello packets are still used to reach other neighbors and build a neighbor adjacency, even on networks that don't support multicast. But the most common networks do support multicast, and you'll see these hello packets sent to the multicast address. Now, inside these hello packets is a bunch of information, and that information is what's going to be used by the routers to determine if a full neighbor adjacency is going to form. So with that said, let's start talking about some of the pieces of information inside a hello packet. The first piece of information inside a hello packet that we're going to discuss is the router ID. The router ID is the identity of each router. And in this case, router 2's router ID is 2.2.2.2. Now that may look like an IP address, but it's not actually an IP address. It's simply a 32-bit value that we represent using dotted decimal because it's familiar to us. Now, you might be asking yourself, if we have an IP address on this link, why do we need a router ID? Well, the idea there is router 2 might end up with a bunch of different interfaces, which means a bunch of different IP addresses. And it's nice to have a single value that can be used to refer to router 2 and all of its connected interfaces. That's why OSPF uses a router ID to identify a router instead of simply an interface IP address. And each router will identify its own router ID inside these hello packets. The next piece of information we're going to discuss inside a hello packet is the hello interval. This is the duration in between these periodic hellos. In this case, router 2 is using the default of 10 seconds. Meaning router 2 is planning to send a hello packet every 10 seconds on this link. Now, closely related to the hello interval is the dead interval timer. The dead interval is a duration that a router is going to remember information about a neighbor if it no longer hears from that neighbor. The idea there is after router 1 and router 2 become full neighbors with one another, router 1 is going to be expecting to see a hello packet from router 2 every 10 seconds. If 40 seconds passes without hearing a hello packet from router 2, router 1 will forget everything that router 2 ever told them, and will assume that router 2 is no longer available in the topology. These periodic hellos end up serving as a health check for the router. Typically, the dead timer is going to be 4 times the hello interval, and you see that here. But of course, you can configure that to whatever you want. The next piece of information inside a hello packet is the neighbors field. The neighbors field is going to include any other neighbor router IDs seen on the link. At the moment, router 2's neighbor field in its hello packet is empty. The reason for that is at this point, router 2 has simply sent hello packets. It hasn't received anything from router 1. So router 2 doesn't know that anyone else actually exists on this link. Hence, it has an empty neighbors field. At some point, router 1 is also going to start sending hello packets. And after that point, router 2's neighbors field is going to include router 1's router ID in that field right there. The purpose that this serves is to verify two-way reachability on the link. When router 1 is going to receive this hello packet, the hello packets from router 1 are going to include router 2's router ID in the neighbors field. If router 2 receives that hello packet, this proves to router 2 that router 1 received the initial hello packet and router 1 was able to send a hello packet back to router 2, which proves to router 2 that there is two-way reachability on this link. This concept is going to be very important later on when we discuss the neighbor adjacency process. So keep in mind that the neighbors field is going to include all the router IDs seen on this particular link. Next, we come to the area ID. This is also a value that is included in hello packets. And you can see here that router 2 thinks this interface is in area 0. From that, we can determine that router 2 must be a backbone router. Next, we have authentication data. Often in production networks, you only want to do OSPF peering with other routers that you designate. Well, the way you do that is by setting a password within OSPF and mandating that you will only form a neighbor relationship with other routers that include that same password. Well, that password information is included in the authentication data section of the hello packet and is included in every single hello packet that is sent by each router. In this case, router 2 is not currently doing password-restricted peering. Hence, there's nothing in the contents of this field. And finally, this brings us to the network mask. This is also a value that is included in all the hello packets. In this case, router 2 believes this IP address to be a part of a /24 network. So those are the first 7 items that we've discussed inside a hello packet. We have a few more items to discuss, but for each of the items that follow, we're going to go into more detail about them later on in the series. For now, I just want to give you their definition, so you have an idea of their purpose inside the OSPF hello packet. The first of the additional items inside a hello packet that we're going to discuss is the area type. And there are 3 options for area type: normal, stub, and NSSA. To talk about them, we're going to use the same topology we used when we discussed areas back in lesson 2. The first type of area is a normal area. This is actually the default area type, meaning if you don't explicitly tell an area that it is a stub or NSSA area, it'll assume to be a normal area. In a normal area, every type of route is allowed. So let me explain that. Let's say our area 0 has 10 routes, and our area 99 also has 10 routes, and our area 88 also has 10 routes, and the EIGRB topology happens to have 100 routes. These 100 routes are going to be redistributed by router 7 into our OSPF domain. Now, if we left area 88 as the default area type, meaning a normal area, the routers inside area 88 are going to have the 30 routes from OSPF plus the 100 routes that are externally redistributed into OSPF. Which means if area 88 is a normal area, area 88 is going to have 130 routes. And with that in mind, we can now introduce a stub area. A stub area is an optimization of a normal area. It allows you to reduce the amount of routes that exist in a particular area. For example, if we made area 88 a stub area, what that would do is it would prevent any redistributed route from appearing in area 88. Instead, to reach the redistributed networks, area 88 would include a default route, pointing the routers inside the stub area to the APR. So if area 88 was a stub area, it would only have the 30 routes from OSPF plus the 1 default route, which is going to replace any redistributed route. Which then brings us to the last area type, NSSA. And to talk about it, we're going to have to change our topology just slightly. We're going to have router 5 redistribute some RIP routes. Now, the specific protocol that's in use is arbitrary. I'm simply picking RIP and EIGRP. Understand these concepts apply to any form of redistribution. In any case, let's just say that there are 50 routes in this RIP domain. And router 5 is going to be redistributing all 50 of these routes into area 88. Or at least it's going to try to. Remember, where we left off was that area 88 was a stub area. And in a stub area, no redistributed routes can exist. Which means the routers in area 88 will not accept a redistributed route from this external domain. Plus, the default route is pointing to the ABR, away from the ASBR. So in this design, if area 88 was left as a stub area, there would be no connectivity to the 50 networks in this RIP domain. Now, of course, we could make area 88 a normal area once again. If we did, area 88 routers would have the 30 routes from OSPF, the 100 from this external domain redistributed by router 7, and the 50 from this external domain redistributed by router 5. Which means if this were the topology and area 88 was a normal area, the routers in area 88 would have 180 routes total. This is what then brings us to the third type of area, which is sort of like a blend of these two. An NSSA area is a not so stubby area. It's sort of stubby, but not entirely. So let me explain. An NSSA area still doesn't allow redistributed routes like a stub area, but it does allow redistribution from the local area. Meaning, if Area 88 were an NSSA route, it wouldn't allow the redistributed routes from Router 7, but it would allow the redistributed routes from Router 5. If we made Area 88 an NSSA area, the routers in that area would have 80 routes. So you can see how it's an optimization that sits somewhere in between these two area types. Now, the one additional thing I'll mention is that in not-so-stubby routes, this default route is optional. The idea there is we want the administrator to make that decision, because it's possible we may want the default route pointing to the ASBR instead of the default route pointing to the ABR. That's up to the administrator. Either way, that's a rundown on the three types of areas that exist in OSPF. Now we're going to go into more detail about each of these later on in this course. For now, I simply want to give you a definition. Now it's possible I went into more detail than you actually need at this point, but I would rather that than the alternative. For now, understand that there are three types of areas, and the type of area is advertised by each router inside a hello packet. Which brings us to the last item or set of items that we're going to discuss inside a hello packet. And those items are the designated router, or the DR, the backup designated router, or the BDR, and the priority number. To talk about these three concepts, we're going to extend the topology from router 2. We're going to add a switch and connect three more routers, and we're going to have router 2, router 3, router 4, and router 5 all be neighbors with each other. Now, in normal OSPF processing, what happens is as soon as a router learns something new, it's instantly going to try and update all of its neighbors. So if router 1 learns a new LSA, it's instantly going to say, oh, I just learned something new, I have to tell all my friends, and it's going to send an update to router 2 with the new information. Router 2 is then going to do the same thing. It's going to say, oh, I just learned something new, I have to tell all of my friends, and it's going to send an update to router 3, router 4, and router 5. Then router 3, having just learned something new, is now going to update all of its friends, letting its friends know that it learned something new. In the same way, router 4 is going to do the same thing, and router 5 also will end up doing the same thing. Now, of course, you and I can see that all of this flooding is redundant. They're all updating each other with the same information. The way OSPF avoids that is by using these three items. The way it works is on a multi-axis segment like this one right here, which includes these four routers, a single designated router is elected. And that designated router is responsible for all the updates on that link. So for example, let's say router 3 becomes our designated router. And if the same situation plays itself out and router 2 learns something from router 1, it's only going to send the update to the designated router, in this case router 3. And then router 3 is responsible for passing that on to the other routers on this link. This is how OSPF avoids the redundant updates when multiple routers exist on the same link. Now, in addition to a designated router being elected on every link, a backup designated router is also elected. The job of the BDR is to take over as the DR if something were to happen to router 3. And finally, the priority number is actually how the selection takes place. The way it works is by default, every router interface has a priority number of 1, and if I wanted to influence who becomes the DR and the BDR, I can set a higher priority number. For instance, I can set router 3 as 50 and router 4 as 25, and they would become the DR and the BDR, respectively. That's the purpose of these three items, and all three of them exist in the hello packet. Every router in the hello packet is going to include the IP address of who they think is the DR, the IP address of who they think is the BDR, and finally, their own interface priority number. The last idea I want to leave you with insofar as this concept is that when I say multi-access, what I mean is any link with the potential for multiple access. So here's what I mean by that. Look at router 1 and router 2. You and I can see that they are directly connected to each other. But if router 1 and router 2 are connected with an Ethernet cable, they have no way of knowing that there's not a hub or a switch on this link as well. You and I, of course, can see this because we can see the topology, but they have no way of knowing that. Which means at some point in the future, a new router might be added to this link. and therefore they would consider this a multi-access link, simply because the technology that they're using supports multiple access. And despite there being only two routers on this link, they would still do a DR and BDR election. One of these routers would become the DR, and the other one would become the BDR. And so that wraps up our discussion of these three items. And we're going to have a dedicated lesson where we unpack this a bit further. For now, just know a high-level definition of what each of these three are, and understand that each of them are included inside hello packets. And with that said, we actually wrap up everything we meant to communicate to you in this lesson, to include the first seven items we discussed inside a hello packet, and the four additional items we discussed inside a hello packet. The last idea I want to leave you with is understanding which of these pieces of information must match for a neighbor adjacency to form. I told you earlier that the content of a hello packet is going to decide whether router 1 and router 2 are going to become neighbors with one another. They're going to do that based upon these six pieces of information. First, the hello interval and the dead interval. Those have to match for router 1 and router 2 to become neighbors with one another. Consider if router 2 is using the default of 10-second hello intervals and 40-second dead intervals, but router 1 is using more aggressive values, for instance, 2-second hello intervals and 8-second dead intervals. What's going to happen is between every one of these periodic hellos, router 1 is going to forget that router 2 exists. That's going to cause a lot of topology flapping. Therefore, these two items must match for router 2 and router 1 to become neighbors with each other. Then we have the area ID. If router 2 thinks this interface is in area 0, and router 1 thinks this interface is in area 25, then they clearly aren't going to understand how they should share routes with another. So they both have to agree what area that they are in. Which then brings us to the authentication data. And again, the whole purpose of authentication data is to do password-restricted peering. So if the authentication data that R1 sends doesn't match the authentication data that R2 sends, then clearly they will not become neighbors with another. Which then brings us to the network mask. And remember, if these routers are doing OSPF with each other, the purpose is to share routes about the networks that they know about. But if router 2 thinks this network is a /24, and router 1 thinks this network is a /23, if they can't even come to an agreement on the network that is directly connected between the two of them, then they definitely won't have agreement on the networks that exist on either side of the routers. So while it seems trivial, the network mask is also a value that must match for these two routers to become neighbors. And finally, the area type. If router 2 thinks this is a normal area and router 1 thinks this is a stub area, they will not form as a neighbor adjacency. They must agree upon what type of area they are connected to, in addition to the actual area number as well. So that wraps up everything we wanted to communicate to you in this lesson. The main takeaway is understanding everything inside a hello packet, how it's used, and which pieces must match for two routers to form a neighbor adjacency. In the next lesson, we're going to take a look at the actual adjacency process. We're going to show you all the packets and all the neighbor states that two routers will go through in order to become fully adjacent. As always, if you enjoyed this content and think it should be shown to a wider audience, you can help me out by liking, leaving a comment, and subscribing. Those three things tell YouTube to show this video to more people. And they go a long way in encouraging me to continue producing high-quality free training content for you. Either way, that's it for this video. I hope you enjoyed this lesson. I want to thank you for watching, and we'll see you in the next one.